Some people call me the space cowboy. Yeah. Some call me the gangster of love. Some people call me Maurice. Cause I speak of the pompous.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Hero Movie Podcast, your greatest source for superhero movie discussion in the multiverse. I'm your host, Adam Portress, and joining me today, you should see him karate kicking a suit, Sweet Chones of Kovacs from the internet.
This is the worst intro song we've ever had. I'm usually so complimentary because you do such a great job. This song sucks.
You've made an enemy today, my friend. And the intro I wrote last week is good enough for this week. So he's still anime dad, Bruce Leslie.
I'm a prickly pear, and my drip game is on point.
Oh, he's dripping all over the place. We got to get some towels over here. It's disgusting. But I know what that really means. Because for example, everybody, you don't know this. You certainly don't know it because we don't have enough followers yet. But HMP just joined the world of TikTok, everybody. Did you know that?
What?
Woohoo!
That's right. Alex, one of our Patreon supporters, sent a thing and just said, hey, look, not for nothing, but I'm over here on TikTok. I share, these are his words, crummy memes. And he's getting, a decent amount of, views and stuff like that. He just goes, put your show on there, get it out to people. And so we're going to do that. We're going to post some weird little stupid content on TikTok. So look us up at Hero Movie Podcast on the TikToks. I can't believe I'm saying that as an almost 40-year-old man. But here we are.
You should use the terrible music that you intro our show with to make a TikTok.
You should make the space cowboy dance.
I
did a dance on TikTok that went viral with it.
Okay. First and foremost,
did it actually go viral?
No.
It would if he did it.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. That would be the worst thing ever. Okay. I will go ahead and preface this with this. There will be no Adam dancing on the TikToks. I'll just go ahead and put that on Front Street right here and now.
I want to see you try to do the jerk while Space Cowboy's playing.
That seems like some lost revenue to me, Portress.
First and foremost, though, if I know anything, and I know at least a little bit about a lot, Bruce Leslie is the dancer in this group. I have seen video
guilty as charged
of him busting a move at a wedding, and like it honestly you couldn't wipe the smile off my face for a half hour just watching Bruce just boogie on down. And the best part is his wife kept the video going for a long time. You'd think he would start
too long if you ask me.
Yeah, you'd think he'd start to get a little bit tired or something. But no, he soldiered on so hard in that and just jamming. And it'd be like, there'd be a little tiny dip and then boom, right on back to it. Grooving and shaking. So maybe I'll get Bruce's the login for the TikTok and he can do us a dance.
I grew up a huge, massive fan of reruns. So I'm down with
it. And probably Solid Gold. I'm guessing you learned a couple of things from watching Solid Gold.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Well, this week, everybody, we are checking out Cowboy Bebop on Netflix. That was our Patreon select this week, because I don't know if you know this, but if you go over to patreon.com/HMP, you get pre-show, post-show, and Dinger Zone. You get to vote on what we watch every month. And because December's chock-a-block full of movies here, we had to do the Patreon vote a little bit early here. So we had, JoJo's Bizarre Adventure and Mark Miller's Super Crooks, apparently don't nobody want to see those. Those were dead tied for last.
At zero each.
Not quite, but not far off. So then we had Wheel of Time coming in for the third place. Fourth place was hotly contested. Only a couple of votes separate Arcane League of Legends and Cowboy Bebop live action, but Cowboy Bebop won out just by the skin of its teeth over here. So we're going to be talking about the first two episodes of Cowboy Bebop this week, and what better timing to do it as the show has now been canceled.
Just like our Jupiter's Legacy podcast.
You know what's hilarious is that, like, seriously, I said this ends on the voting ends on Wednesday night, and I don't know if it was Wednesday night or early Thursday when I heard the news. By the way, they've canceled this season. You're like, all right, well, I guess that's that.
And I gotta say, Netflix is awful quick to pull that trigger. Like, people don't even have a chance to get around to watching something, and it's already canceled now. I don't get it.
It's really I think it's tough because they put out so much stuff, and it's like if it's not kicking right away, they just go like, no. I don't know how much this show costs to produce. It doesn't look necessarily cheap, but it doesn't look like they spent Star Wars money on it. I guess
they spent a lot of money on it.
we'll talk about all that. But before we do, like I said, we do want to say a big thank you to those patreon.com/HMP supporters, pre-show, post-show, Dinger Zone. You know all the kind of good stuff. This week, we have somebody who's actually been supporting us for a minute, but has not jumped back on, or we have not given him a nickname as of yet. And we toss it to Sweet Shaunzi for the ceremony.
Oh, well, so we have a new Patreon member. His name is Thomas Steele, which is the greatest, most manly name I've ever heard.
It really feels like you could just punch anything and it would just explode, doesn't it?
I mean, if my name was Thomas Steele, I would force everyone to say my full name all the time when referring to me. I really would.
Yeah.
But as our tradition here, when you join the HMP leagues, you get your own HMP nickname. And so as has been my want to do lately, I researched a little bit into the folks' name. And this week, Thomas Steele, I have a very interesting thing that came up with your name, Thomas, which is that there is a stuntman who has the name Thomas Steele, and he's worked on just a bunch of different projects. But here's the thing, that wasn't his original name. So when he joined the Actors Guild, you can only have one person with that name. And so his original name was already being used. So he went with Thomas Steele. His original name was Thomas Scotch, which is also an awesome name. And so Thomas Steele, from this point forward, your HMP nickname will be Scotch.
Scotch. Delicious. So, all right. If you too would like an HMP nickname and help support this show, patreon.com/HMP. Doesn't matter what level that you join up at. You get all those kind of bonuses and all that kind of good stuff. We really appreciate all of you fine people. And of course, if you can't afford to do that, that is perfectly fine. Always do is just say, tell somebody about the show, or do us one even better. Grab your grandma's cell phone, start downloading the show, type into the review there that we're the best, 5 stars, AKA Humdinger.
I'm digging.
There you go. And we'd really appreciate all of that. So like we said, this week, all of those awesome people over at Patreon voted, and they said, you guys ought to be watching that Netflix Cowboy Bebop. Let's find out if they're right. Here's a trailer for Cowboy Bebop.
So what brings you back from the dead?
A week ago, I did a job. A bounty. I had a partner, believe it or not.
He know what you used to be. Will I ever see you again?
They tried to kill me, Anna. If you need to find me, I go by Spike Spiegel these days. Solar system. If the cops and the bounty hunters don't get you, the syndicate will. There's no happy ending here.
Spoken like a man who's never been in love.
I was.
What happened?
I was dreaming.
What do you say, fellas? You want to team up?
I was thinking a 60-40 split.
Going my way, of course.
Do not shoot her.
Please?
No.
What the actual?
We're a team. The three of us. Go grab some bounties.
Please, I just want to kill her a little bit.
Damn it, Spike.
It's Jim.
Guys. Or bad guys.
Depends on who you ask.
Oh, righty, that was the trailer for Cowboy Bebop. I'll say this, at least the music's on point. You know what time it is, everybody.
It's time for Bruce's Comic Book Connection.
Bruce, what do you got this week?
Cowboy Bebop was conceived as an anime from the very beginning, but it did have two manga series. The first one, titled Cowboy Bebop Shooting Star, went into publication at the end of 1997, several months before the anime premiered the following year, giving the show a feeling of, I guess you could say, legitimacy, sort of offering the possibility that it may have been based on a manga, which is kind of the more common course of events in 90s anime, I think, though, you know, nothing's ever universal. But the manga was published by Kadokawa Shoten, and a second series following the anime was published from 1998 to 2000. Now, in reality, it was not the manga, but the anime that brought acclaim to the Cowboy Bebop franchise. The series made its way to the United States in 2001 and was the first anime broadcast on Adult Swim. And it just so happens, if you were a college kid in 2001 and you came home at midnight under the influence of only God knows what kind of mind-altering substance, clicking on Cowboy Bebop just might have been your jam. The atmospheric art and sound with the meandering jazz soundtrack, well, it wasn't in a hurry to get anywhere. It was totally about enjoying the ride. Given this mainstream appeal to the first wave of U.S. millennials, Cowboy Bebop has been called a gateway series for anime. I don't know for certain if it influenced the space western Firefly, but it sure feels like it did to me. So if you like a ragtag group of bounty hunters, including a former hitman, a space cop, and a genetically engineered corgi, well, Cowboy Bebop is definitely an anime worth watching. And speaking of genetically engineered corgis, Adam, do you have a list?
I do, because if that comic connection wasn't enough for you, let me sell everybody on this freshly canceled Netflix property, because this show's got everything. We got a live-action anime, that guy from the White Castle movie, jazz, drinking, eyeball drugs, not enough smoking if you ask me. We got the cold black vacuum of space, bad Rocky Horror Picture Show cosplay, Asian Eyes Wide Shut. Speaking of cosplay, we also get one of them shows where the character is always wearing the same thing, so that's always good. Dirty, dirty, dirty clothes. Speaking of wearing, we got a half naked, half burned, half crazy person wearing a giant bear head. Noodle talk, Firefly level cinematography, not a compliment. Some of the most awkward fights and shooting of a fights I've seen in a long time. Kicking, punching, shooting, exploding, space casinos. This show's got everything.
Oh man, we've got a lot to talk about, Adam.
Yes, we do.
Yeah, it's funny because we talked about this probably off air or something. Probably our Patreon people heard it. But I had mentioned, like, the week before this show came out, I decided to watch the first episode of the Cowboy Bebop anime.
Yes.
Which may have been a mistake for me. Because
how so? Tell us more about that.
Because I enjoyed that anime.
Yes, I enjoyed the anime too.
It was only one episode, and it was kind of quick, but like, I dug the vibe. I kind of saw what they were doing and everything, and all I could think of while watching that before this came out was like, how are they going to do this?
See, and I had the same thought, and when you're saying that you think that the fights were sort of poorly choreographed and shot, I thought it was kind of brilliant to bring that anime feel to it. Because it's not something that you could do and look realistic at all. And they were willing to embrace, like, the ridiculousness in order to love the source material. And some might say they love the source material a little too much. That could be the problem. But I kind of like the atypical appearance of that, particularly that first fight. I mean, that cold opening in the casino, the very first episode, that had won so much goodwill over for me. It took a while before I got a little cool on the show.
I have no entry into Cowboy Bebop at all. I knew nothing about it. I mean, literally nothing about it. I'd heard the name before. I knew that it was very popular on Adult Swim, and I'd never gotten around to even seeing a frame of it. So I didn't know I knew nothing about the show. I didn't know that it took place in space. I didn't know that it was bounty hunters. I had no idea. I love the show.
Wow.
I love it, love it, love it. And here is there's three reasons why. One is, this is a natural progression for me from those movies in the mid 2000s, like your 300 or your Sin City, this would be the progression of that. You know, the second Sin City movie, what made that movie so awful was that it was done poorly, but also that there was nothing new. They weren't showing you anything new. Whereas this movie, if they would have made that second Sin City look like this show does, I think that it would have been far more well received than the sequel to Sin City was.
If I could interject just for a minute, I love that your review of the second Sin City is, my only criticism is that it was made poorly.
Outside of that, perfectly fine.
So that's part one. Part two is the music in this show is so amazing. It is the best soundtrack. It hits every little thing that I love. It's a style of music that you don't hear on this type of show, which makes it perfect. And the intro song to the show, I love it so much that I got all of it on Spotify immediately because I just love it so much. So that's part two, because that's the superstar of this show is the music. Yes.
Same goes for the anime, in my opinion. And it's the same guy. They brought the same guy back for the
show. Oh, that's great. That's great. And then the third thing is John Cho himself, because John Cho, my God, that man looks great in that blue suit. He looks fantastic in this show. I keep saying movie. He looks fantastic in this show. And I like him instantly, probably because it's John Cho. I mean, honestly. But he is so different than anything I've ever seen him do before, because he's playing a hipster cool guy, which I really did not expect from this at all. And especially it being John Cho, because he doesn't play that guy usually. And he is fantastic in the show. And I get that if you are a Cowboy Bebop fan and you are and you have seen the live action version of this, I am sure every word that is coming out of my mouth right now, you are just screaming in your car. Wrong, wrong, wrong. But I don't have any reference. All I have is the show. And so, you know, I watched the two episodes, and I had to pull myself away because I had other things to do. Nice. But I am totally watching the rest of the show. I cannot wait to see the rest of the show.
And honestly, my advice, and I think it's still on Netflix, right, Adam? But check out the first two episodes of the anime.
Not until I'm done with the live action, because I'm sure it's kind of like reading Jurassic Park after you've seen the movie, because that's the way to do that. After you see Jurassic Park, read the book, because the book is a far better thing than the movie is.
Yeah, I did it backwards. I read the book. Well, this is not the Jurassic Park podcast.
Not yet.
I'm interfering.
But that's and that's the theory, is that, you know, I now know, oh, I'm really enjoying the show. I don't want to have it ruined by something that's vastly superior. So I'm going to wait until I see all the rest of the episodes, and then I'll go backwards. Because my God, man, the mood of this show hit me so perfectly at the right time, where I was just like, man, this is exactly what I'm looking for.
And, you know, for me, having recently seen the anime myself, I hadn't seen the anime until, I don't know, around May or something. And one thing that I like about it, like, had I not seen the anime, I wouldn't appreciate how much this embraces things from the anime that you'd be very tempted to change for the live action adaptation. So that's like a whole dimension that I enjoy about it, that, you know, that's what I'm saying. Hey, you might just check out the first episode, or at least just check out the intro. Like to the anime, just the intro sequence, and hear the music and see just how much alike it is. It's beautiful.
Yeah, at least the way they've done it. For sure that intro, because they looked at the animated one and go, yeah, we're doing that.
That's how the show is. They're like, so how are you going to put your spin on it? Oh, my spin is we're going to try to reproduce it pretty faithfully, but not predictably, and move it a little different pace. I'm impressed. Especially because, like, Western live action adaptations of anime are kind of like video game movies. They don't have a great track record.
Right.
So seeing this show actually be decent, like, you know, imagine a decent video game movie is going to be awesome compared to other video game movies. So a decent Western adaptation of anime. I mean, up until this point, all we really had was Alita Battle Angel. And now we got two things that I can say are done all right.
I was surprised by John Cho, and I was really surprised by when I saw Bushmaster show up. I was like, holy crap, Bushmaster's in this.
Did you ever watch The Deuce?
No.
Oh, he's Big Mike on The Deuce. I know him as that probably a little better than Bushmaster, because for some reason I watched The Deuce.
I did not expect this actor to have this sort of range, because he's unrecognizable. But I kept recognizing his voice. And so finally, I think I was almost done with the first episode and went, oh, he's from Luke Cage.
Season two, though, the lesser season.
Yeah.
Yes. Well,
that much is true.
But still, Bushmaster was a pretty cool villain. Yeah. I do like him. Not like the first season of Luke Cage, though. You're right. So, Adam, how much of this show made you crazy?
A decent amount of it. Like I went in with, you know, an open mind and everything, and really wanting to kind of enjoy this. And like I said, I'd seen one episode and forgot it like real quick, cause it was like late at night when I watched it. So it's not like I had a ton to compare to, but I had at least enough of an idea in mind as to, you know, what I was kind of getting into. And for whatever reason, it feels like, I mean, this is, and I think you guys would attest to this should be something that's kind of right up my alley, you know? You've got the Western stuff, you've got the sci-fi stuff, you've got, you know, the jazz stuff, all of these things kind of formed together. It should be something that I really enjoy, but ultimately for me is it feels like it falls short on the execution. I don't think it looks good at all. Like this is going from like 22 minutes of the first episode, or however long that is. It ain't long. Of that, watching that is like, there's an aesthetic to it. You know, it's gritty, it's grimy. This looks like a television show, and like not like a good television show. That was one of the cool things about Star Wars. When Star Wars came out, they gave us a space that was unlike what we'd seen in 2001, which is unlike what we'd seen in Star Trek. This was a gritty, lived-in world. In the little bit that I saw of the anime, it feels like that's that world. Here, this world seems like it just got a brand new fresh coat of paint. And
the first episode of the anime is almost all in like this pseudo Western town. It's about the lady who appears pregnant with the vials of red eye in her stomach. That's the in her fake pregnant belly. That is the entire first episode of the anime. So it is going to look a little dirtier from that regard too, Adam, just because where that particular episode takes place. Mm-hmm. But it also goes to the casinos and the bright lights and the inner cities and stuff. So it does spread its wings a little bit.
And I like the music. I don't like the music's marrying to this show, because for some reason when it makes this transition, for whatever reason, it's cloying to me. I wish I liked it, but I'm just like, oh, it feels like you're trying so hard, and like, in it doesn't feel like it's coming natural. It feels like they're just going like, and we're Cowboy Bebop too. Believe it. I don't know.
I totally disagree with you, but I now see why you chose that terrible, terrible song as the intro instead of the brilliant intro music to the actual show.
My only complaint about the intro song you picked is that it was not done very well.
Now I'm beset on all sides.
Now you're going to tell me that Blinded by the Light's better Springsteen version? Incorrect. Go ahead. No, that was Manfred Mann. I'm sorry. I'm not editing that out. Don't worry.
Springsteen did write the song, though.
He wrote the song. He just wanted to do this like weird, crappy Bob Dylan version, and then Manfred Mann just goes like, "I'm going to make it a psychedelic weirdo song," and it's like 10 times better. Sorry, boss. Go on.
Clear eyes, full hearts, can't lose. So what I'm trying to get to here is that when I hear the name Cowboy Bebop, basically what my original thought was, because I'm a middle-aged white dude, is that is some manga crap. It's literally what was in my head originally. But now I am a full convert to at least the live action show. Maybe something weird will happen and there'll be some sort of weird, crazy mix up when I'm done with the live action and I watch the animated and I hate it. Like, that would be so funny.
That would be weird. Like, you're boy. The guy who prefers this to the original. Oh, that would be great.
Yeah, it's like
the one guy whose favorite Star Wars movie is Episode 2.
Exactly. But, excuse me, I don't need anything else except more Bad Batch, please.
I got a Martez sisters tattoo.
So you know it came as such a shock to me because it literally is about the mood of the whole thing, and it's not real. I mean, the story is you know the story also, but it's far more about the mood than it is about the story, which I really enjoy. I very much enjoyed watching, and there's stuff in it that is like a little bit like had me at times going like, you know, the reason why Loki's tech looks like Loki's tech is because it comes from all parts of time. Like what you guys are doing, there's no reason for what you have, you know? And my concern about the show is my concern about moving forward when it comes to stuff like this is that because Loki is such an interesting look, the way that that everything is designed on that show, that we're going to be seeing more and more of that because it's so different than anything else we had seen, except for maybe Brazil, you know, 30 years ago. Yeah. And so I'm interested to see if this trend continues, because clearly someone, I understand that that this is the tech that's probably on the cartoon also, but there is absolutely a Loki influence on the design of the show.
I see that. Yeah, there's no doubt about that.
Yeah. And so, there has to be a reason for it. That's my only complaint. There should be a reason for it. Loki, there is a reason why the TVA looks the way it does. It's because it's out of time. It's what makes it so interesting. Anyway,
a lot of choices were just purely aesthetic choices.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, like the name in there, Bebop, I don't necessarily know enough to explain like what sets Bebop apart from other parts of jazz, but just think a lot of it's just about jamming. Like, we're not playing a song, we're playing a mood. And that's kind of what the show does sometimes, is play a mood. Yep. It's like Sunday afternoon, you're going along for the ride, not for the destination.
Yeah. And what did you guys think of John Cho here?
He impressed me. I had set my expectations low, but for me, when it comes to Spike Spiegel, it really came down to the hair. I think he nailed the hair. So, and he clearly has affection for the character. It's not just a paycheck. At least it didn't come across that way on screen.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think I agree with those statements. However, I didn't care for it. And I like John Cho. I like John Cho a lot in the majority of his movies. I even saw that one where he's like on the computer trying to find his kid and all that kind of stuff. Pretty decent flick, by the way. I forget the name of it though. Bad name, but good movie.
Dark Web.
Computer Kid.
No, what? No, no. Definitely wasn't
Daryl.
Daryl.
Unfriended.
No, there's a lot of movies that were like that, but it's, shucks, I don't remember. Anyways, but I'm a fan of his, and as much as I like him, I don't buy him in this character in the least. I want to buy that kind of, you know, cool sort of, you know, Han Solo vibe that you're supposed to be getting, and I don't get it at all.
I don't think that he's supposed to be Han Solo at all.
I'd say he's closer to Deckard than Han Solo.
Okay, but... Yeah, but I mean, he's funner than Deckard is, for sure, though.
He's more of a Dash Rendar, am I right, guys?
yeah, definitely.
But he's, I don't know, he's supposed to have, I wish I could tell you what exactly it is. I can't quite put my finger on it, but I just don't, I know that he's invested in the character and is invested in giving us a good performance. For my taste, I don't like what it is, and I wish I could point it out and give you a darn good reason.
Is it because you just don't buy John Cho as an anti-hero? Is that what it is?
No, like I really, like I said, I wanted to see him do something, and like I guess now I'm kind of thinking about it. Maybe I just need kind of a we need to lean either more towards in kind of like he's more of a screw up in everything who doesn't quite know what's going on. So it needs to be like perhaps a little bit lighter or needs to be a little bit more serious. It's in a weird middle ground that I don't really see it, you know, working out one way or the other.
The vibe I'm kind of getting from you, Adam, and Sean, tell me if you're picking this up too, but I think something didn't set with you early on. And then you just were a little bit hypercritical from then on out. Like if you get a Band-Aid in your appetizer, I don't care how good the entree is, you're going to complain about it. So I feel like something kind of hit you right up front and then you just were not down for it.
I think a lot of it really has to, you know, come off with the casino scene because like there are elements of it that I'm okay with, but there are overall, like I said, I don't like the cinematography in this show. I don't think it looks good. I think it has that like Yanis Kaminsky, like over, too hot of a headlight, behind you and everything, just like creating just the weirdest head halos and stuff that have ever been put on people. There's so much of that stuff going on. It's far too clean. And I think the fight scenes are horribly shot. I don't like any of it.
I love them. They're so atypical to me.
Yeah, they're atypical, but they look like garbage. It's like if you were atypical and like in this, and the choreography looked like it was quite on point, it looks like these are practice videos. It doesn't look like they you know worked it out as well as they could, or at least they do need to cover that with enough. The camera.
Yes. I think it's stylistic enough that it's going into the point where it's a matter of taste.
Yes.
Like, I don't think it's incompetent. I don't think it's bad what they were doing. They intended it to look the way it looked. So I think it just comes down to a matter of like, you don't like it or you do like it. But I think it's more a matter of taste than like saying.
I totally agree.
Now the over the top elements, I got no problem with that. I wish that was a thing that because like you know when in a Robert Rodriguez movie someone gets shot with a gun and flies 10 feet backwards, I'm all for it. That kind of stuff I don't care about. If you want to do fantastical things are a little bit over the top. I'm just saying that there are a lot of just like what I would just ultimately call really bad coverage. Bad coverage and bad editing.
But so much of it would have probably mirrored the storyboards from some of the fights in the anime. And like some of that was to save a little bit of animation cost. But like you'll have a strike that rather than being animated, it's really a still that they just zoom in on and you dwell on it for a minute. And you see a lot of that like hand to hand and they dwell on it and zoom in just like they would with the anime. And that is where I'm saying maybe it was a little too in love with the source material for some people. But I got a kick out of that.
Hmm.
Yeah, I like it.
And when he kicked the coin, I mean, come on, that was just pretty cool.
I'm fine with that. It's also something that we don't see. You know, that's why.
That's what I'm getting at. It's atypical. And you know, how many more hallway fights did we need to see 3 or 4 years ago?
Right.
So to me, it's cool to see something a little late. And there's been so many fight scenes over the years that it's hard to find a new spin on it. I kind of enjoyed it.
Me too. Totally did. I also think that the pacing of the show, because you guys keep talking about how the anime is slower pace.
Here's what I'll say is the anime, it's 22 minutes per episode. So 60 minutes of the show and 60 minutes of the anime cover the same amount of material. But because you're on episode 3 in the anime, it feels like it's paced slower when you're still at the end of episode 1 on the live action. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah.
If you look at it, it's probably about the same pace per minute. But, you know, when you have it broken up with an intro, an opening and a closing, and then maybe a little bit of time in between, it feels slower paced, but it's probably about the same. It's just I say, gee, episode 1 covered so much more ground than episode 1 of the anime, but episode 1 of the live action is probably close to 3 times as many minutes. Mm-hmm.
So what are you guys' thoughts on our kind of co-conspirator / pilot of our ship? And do we know what the ship's name is? I don't know.
The ship's name is the Bebop.
Oh, that's right. That's right. That's right.
And the are you talking about Jet Black?
Yes.
Yeah, Jet Black, a name that a person writing a story in Japan would be more comfortable using probably than someone in the U.S.
I don't know. Yes. That's a pretty good name. I like as far as names go, I'm like, that's pretty good.
Yeah. And also, like the way the naming convention works, I'm sure in Japanese it's like Jetu Braku, but you know, Jet Black is the English translation. Like it's, what is it, Spiku Spigeru? That's, I think, his name because they don't use a lot of L's. But yeah, Jet Black, not a name you'd expect.
No, I like him. You know, again, this is another actor who I didn't know that he had this speed. You know, I thought that he played it a lot cooler, and he's funny. You know, he's not funny at all in Luke Cage.
Yeah.
And so to have him be such a good partner. I mean, he's not a sidekick. He's more of a partner.
Yeah, he has a little bit of good, like, straight man funny in The Deuce. Like he's not intending to be funny, but it's funny. You know what I mean?
I see.
The delivery. Yeah, so I see
like some of that. Like, his timing is there, is what you're saying.
Yeah, and again, kind of a tough guy that's kind of a teddy bear at the same time.
Uh-huh. And on this show, just seeing, there's so many times where he's saying so much more than he's actually saying, which I did not expect from this actor at all. And so it was just such a nice surprise that the two leads of this show, I like them both. I just think they're so good together too, that it's kind of one of those things where it's like, man, we're going to see, you know, The Rock and Kevin Hart for the next 20 years in every single thing ever. And that's fine if you're into that. But to me, these two are a far better duo than those two.
Man, it would be kind of great if suddenly this two did become like a team. And they made a few more projects.
I mean, I think that they're that good together. I really do.
I agree.
So, like, I mean, outside of, like, ratings and, I mean, but who knows what Netflix ratings are anymore? I don't know how much this thing costs per episode. It looks like it's expensive, but, like, sometimes not expensive to me at the same time, too. Which, again, I think that kind of goes down. I think that's more of my cinematography argument.
Yeah, I mean, you know this as well as anybody, that there's different ways to be expensive. Like, yeah. Netflix said one of the most expensive shows they ever produced was Jupiter's Legacy, and that
which
show
is hilarious.
Look expensive.
No, yeah. That thing looks dirt cheap.
Yeah,
I mean, like a fourth of the cost of whatever this thing is.
I'm guessing that there's a producer somewhere who's like
flying
on their personal jet and going, I don't know what happened to the money. I have no idea.
I told them they shouldn't have used real diamonds. Nobody could tell on camera if they were prop diamonds or real diamonds.
But somehow they just mysteriously disappeared off the set. What do you know?
But I think this was expensive because I think there's licensing cost. I think the music was probably kind of expensive. Maybe John Cho doesn't work as cheap as I do. But there's more that can be expensive other than just effects, you know?
I had a question, but I just lost it. Shoot.
They spent over $700,000 a week in marketing is what I read.
Well, I can also tell you that the amount of producers on this show is absolutely ridiculous. There's 28 producers on this show.
They're probably going to have three producers at every point because they're probably like contractually obligated to cut in both the Japanese language and English language anime on top of the people really doing the job. Yeah, so I bet you they have like a triple set of producers.
That sounds right. I wouldn't be surprised.
But that's where your money went. I mean, honestly, you got 28 different people who are producers on the show. That is a whole lot of money to divvy out. That's probably why they also cut ties. Is that there's somebody that they don't want to work with anymore. Netflix doesn't want to work with anymore. And they're like, you know what? We're not dealing with this guy anymore.
Can I make a bold prediction about what I think happened and is a big part of why this got canceled?
I would love to hear it.
I don't know what Netflix paid to get the anime, but I'm guessing it was less than what it cost to produce this show. And I'm going to guess the anime probably got 3 watch hours for every watch hour the live action show got. And they're like, why did we make a live action show when we could have just gotten all these views with this existing anime? That's what I'm guessing.
Why don't we just keep this anime? I mean, for heaven's sake, people, you know, the Netflix All Office was a thing that people kept watching all the time. Why?
Netflix has made, or they've gone into plans to make, season 2s of animes that are like 10, 11 years old. So they may actually say, instead of making a season 2 live action, let's make a season 2 of this anime 20 years later.
Hmm.
That is a question that I had because I didn't really know. How long did the anime go on for?
I think it was 26 episodes.
Just 26, really? It's because I'd heard so much about it for so many years. You'd think it was like one of these, like, you know, One Piece things that's been on since the 90s. You know what I mean?
One Piece is might have even started in the late 80s.
Yeah,
One Piece
exactly.
is like Simpsons level.
It's one of those that's Simpsons ridiculous level. Old.
Yeah. But no, man, it's, I don't know that you call it one season. It was just 26 episodes. Like, okay. They weren't all let out in a regular fashion. I think it was about four or five episodes would get dropped at a time.
Yeah, that sounds like what Adult Swim would do. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, this is in 98 in Japan. When Adult Swim got it, it was complete. But, in Japan, it was like it would come out in sessions, I think. So maybe five or six until they had 26 episodes. And then they did a movie in 2001. And then that was it.
You ever have that? I'm sure everybody's seen the meme here. Manga, anime, Netflix adaptation.
Okay, I'm on the record. That is Chris Elvin's favorite meme in the world because he hates Netflix. He loves anime and manga. And yes, those memes, man, there are thousands of them out there, I think, at this point.
Oh, yeah.
And if you haven't seen these memes, Sean, here's what I'll try to describe it. So it would say, the manga, and it would have a picture of a guy and it's in black and white. Most manga is in black and white, but a guy in a trench coat with like a robot arm, if we're talking about like jet black here. And then it would say, here's the anime, and it would have a picture from the anime. The guy's in a red trench coat with a robot arm. And then it would say, here's the Netflix adaptation, and it would be like a red plastic lawn chair. Only one of the legs has been replaced with a wire coat hanger. Like,
oh, that's good. The
progression.
That's good.
Oh, they're beautiful. They're beautiful.
So I'm guessing that this doesn't quite fall in that particular category for you guys.
Not for me.
Because I was just like, I don't know. And here's the thing. Honestly, with both of you, especially Sean, liking this, I'm willing to go and give more chances for it. And like I said, who amongst us hasn't watched a movie or a TV show or something at some point, maybe been in a mood, and then like it just kind of, you didn't even know that that was what was going on, but somehow it's just like, oh, that just kind of, it just got ruined somehow, and it wasn't anything that was, maybe particularly in your mind. That's all I'm thinking here. Because, you guys seem to like it. Like I said, I wanted to like it, but it just didn't quite hit for me. And like I said, I might try it more just on account of you guys liked it as much. And, I'm willing to learn. I'm willing to stretch my wings and fly.
And I dropped that meme I was describing to you into the chat there.
Oh, very good. Thank you.
But, for me, I wanted to like it a lot more than I did, I guess. But
yeah, I could tell.
Yeah.
But okay, so here's what I want to do, because I think that there's a decent enough chance that we could, do some more of these. I want to go ahead and get Sean to shoot a shot here and tell us what he thinks is going to happen, and then we'll compare and see where we finally land at the end.
What are you asking me? You're asking me where the plot progresses.
Yeah. What would you like to see this show do? What would excite you?
Well, I can only tell you what they've set up so far. So basically, there's going to be something about how they're on Mars, right?
I believe so.
So they're on Mars. So there's going to be some giant, vast conspiracy on Mars, because it's they keep referring to Mars. So there's that. I think also that there's going to be something with the girlfriend that was taken away and is now the girlfriend of our main baddie. I think that that they're going to end up together, or she's going to end up dead. It is an anime. She's probably going to end up dead, or a prostitute.
I was about to say, or taken into some sort of servitude, if you will.
I think that it ends up with him at the very end. The last thing we see is he walks out the door, and they're like, wait a minute, don't you want your medal? He's like, I'm not in it for the medals. I'm in it for the money. And then the music plays and he walks out the door. That's what I think the last shot of the show is.
Or before he gets on a plane, he gets a mysterious phone call. Oh, wait, that's another show.
I'm just guessing.
I think it's going to end exactly like the movie we watched, Akira.
I
think somebody's going to turn into a big gross ball of flesh and the world's going to explode.
I tell you what.
People just screaming Tetsuo for 2 hours.
Yes.
I'm telling you, if you brought that in here, if you brought a giant, squid body monster looking dealy to just, be the size of a skyscraper, I'd watch the rest of the show 100%. 100%. I'd be like, wait a minute. You going to see that for real? Sign me up.
For like 7-8 years, they were talking about a Hollywood live action Akira that never happened.
Oh, so many like names and everything that went through it and stuff.
Oh,
and,
so many. You're right.
But they were, but at the same time too,
Scarlett Johansson.
Oh boy. As Akira, no less.
As every single role.
She'll be great. She'll be so good.
It's going to be like that.
Have you guys seen Black Widow?
Oh yeah.
I haven't gotten around to it yet. I'm waiting till it comes out on CBS.
It's very, very good.
The blockbuster hit. Never mind. All right. So before we get to our rating here and everything, we do have to ask ourselves one very important question: is how this television show relates back 1-to-1 with Sylvester Stallone.
Why, thank you, Adam. I have a prepared statement. Good evening, Mr. Stallone. This week, you're connected to this movie by way of Alan Poppleton, a stunt guy from Auckland, New Zealand. These days, Alan Poppleton is probably best known for working with Dwayne Johnson on his stunt team, which is someone that, quite honestly, I can't believe you haven't worked with yet. How come you haven't worked with Dwayne Johnson? It seems like an easy slam dunkaroo. But he used to be Jason Statham's stunt double. And stunt double for him he did in the movie Expendables 2, which was written by and starred you, Sylvester Stallone. Alan Poppleton is the stunt coordinator on Cowboy Bebop. But his first job as stunt coordinator was on The Chronicles of Narnia. That's a pretty big movie to start on. But Apple Poppleton didn't fold. He brought his A game. And transitioned that job into many more coordinator jobs, including the coordinator on a movie called, I'm going to try to pronounce this correctly, Avatar? Am I saying that right?
Avatar? Oh,
anyway,
never heard of it.
I'm sure these days Alan Poppleton is a millionaire, because if he's The Rock's stunt coordinator, The Rock makes about 12 mediocre movies a year, and that guy is going to be loaded. And save your Twitter responses telling me how The Rock is in The Rundown or some stupid Fast and the Furious movie that you like. The Rock has been in movies since The Mummy Returns. That was 20 years ago. He's made 1,500 movies since then, and while I agree he has a ton of presence and chemistry and personality, I don't think anyone has ever said the line, "For the first 20 minutes, I didn't have any idea that The Rock was in this movie." He just disappeared into the role, and it's my belief that in 20 years, people will be talking about The Rock the same way people talk about Schwarzenegger, only there won't be a Terminator or a Predator that people can look back on. There we will be, however, 15 Kevin Hart unfunny movies that no one can remember the name of because they all sound the same. And there you have it, Mr. Stallone. This week's Stallone Connection is stunt coordinator Alan Poppleton. I'll try to do better next week. Your pal, Sweet Shonzi from the internet.
I was trying to find that one movie where he's, oh, shucks. I forget
Stay
what it
Stay cool.
Is.
Be cool.
Be cool, yeah.
It's the sequel to Get Shorty, and that movie should be set on fire because Get Shorty is an amazing movie directed by someone who is great at their job, and Be Cool is just a sequel.
All right, over here at the Hero Movie Podcast, we have our own patented Robin rating system. If you'd like to check that out, head on over to our Reddit, reddit.com/r/Hero Movie Podcast, right there at the top of the screen. Bruce, for the first two episodes, where does Cowboy Bebop Netflix live action fall in the Robin rating system for you, and do you think that we should go on further?
I give it a Tim Drake. I mean, and I might be grading on a little bit of a scale because I've come to expect the worst out of Netflix lately. But as far as like, if you're watching something on Netflix, you can do a whole lot worse than Cowboy Bebop. So I'm going to give it a Tim Drake, you know, a Netflix grading on the curve.
A Netflix Tim Drake. Tim Drake. Sean.
I think that this is a Tim Drake for sure, but maybe one of our months, because, you know, we're trying to theme months now. Mm-hmm. Maybe one of our months is March back month, like March back month. You know, where we like go back and see things that we didn't finish at, or only maybe saw an episode or two of, you know, because Cowboy, watching the rest of Cowboy Bebop and throwing that and March back March is a pretty, pretty good idea. Anyway, it doesn't have to be March, but whatever. So for me, it's a Tim Drake. I cannot wait to watch the rest of the show. I don't know when I'll have time to do it, but I am going to continue watching it.
Dwayne's best movie is The Tooth Fairy. I think we all know that. And I just, you know, I want to say it out loud. So just everybody.
I prefer the sequel with Larry the Cable Guy.
I think that the Tooth Fairy is far vastly superior to the spinoff of the Fast and the Furious that he was in.
I won't deny you that one. And I've seen both. I would say that you're correct. I even own the I own that one because I ended up buying it for the Dinger Zone. By the way, everybody, if you don't know what's going on in the Dinger Zone, during quarantine and everything, we reviewed all nine at that point Fast and Furious movies. We did all the Matrix movies and stuff like that. So and all the Mission Impossible movies as well. So you can dig back through the archives there. That's a good little Patreon plug for everybody. For these two episodes, for me, I don't know. Like I said, perhaps I was in a mood. I'm not really sure. Stephanie Brown is where I'm landing.
Wow. You really did not like this.
No. Like I said, maybe I had too high a hope for it. Maybe I was just like...
You didn't dig on the style. It's fine.
Yeah, but it just didn't hit me. It works. It seemed to work in the anime, but doesn't really translate over to the live action for me. So I don't know. But... Given this, I don't think, you know, that march back is kind of a bad idea. I think we can, you know, do this and maybe some other things. And that would also, especially we're doing a little show producing here on the fly, everybody. With that as well, being like in March, that can give us plenty of time to watch, you know, especially if it's television, to watch those things and catch up with them so we can, you know, have that at a time. So that's not a bad idea. I like it. Bruce, do you third the motion?
Sure.
Carried. All right. Very good. So that is it for this episode, everybody. We got a pretty big episode coming up next week. But Bruce, in the meantime, where can we find more of your work on the internet?
I'd love for people to check out my YouTube channel, youtube.com/C/Bruce Leslie. Just crossed over 5,000 subscribers. And even if you're not into anime, just go check out my thank you video. It's only 3 minutes. It won't take long. I had a lot of fun making that one. And I show off my impeccable acting skills in that video.
And haberdashery skills. You're looking quite spiffy. So.
Yes, my fit was tight.
My fit was tight. All of the words a man of your age should not be saying. Sean, if they needed some questions to be answered, where might they go?
Oh, man, get ready, everybody, because we got a show called Hawkeye 30 Questions. And man, the reason why the internet seems a little less than it has been recently is because we're taking it all. Hawkeye 30 questions. We have got it. Like, that is us. Like, yes. Yes to Hawkeye 30 questions.
Indeed. And you know, farting chairs and everything. Chair. That's where it gets. So, you know, just farts galore over here. We're so excited we can't hold it in. That's what I'm saying.
Sean's farty chair.
But yeah, so we'll be doing that over at Hawkeye 30 Questions. And as soon as that bad boy is ending up, crank up the band yet again, because we're going to have another Mandalorian 30 Questions talking about the Book of Boba Fett. So,
December 29th.
Oh my gosh. It's hitting real quick here on HMP and all of our following properties and stuff like that. So we really appreciate you guys listening to all those shows, reviewing them and all that kind of good stuff, sharing with a friend. It's pretty much how this show grows. And we also thank all of those people over at patreon.com/HMP. Reminder, pre-show, post-show, Dinger Zone, and get yourself a silly, fun HMP nickname that you can put around everywhere. And I mean everywhere. But next week, of course, we're going to be doing Spider-Man No Way Home. It is selling out across the country. I don't think people understand how much this movie and how much money this movie is going to make. Everybody's talked about, like, oh, this was like the new, everybody's back to the movies and the box office, big deal, big deal, big deal. I think Spider-Man's going to blow all of those previous kind of like, oh, we're finally back movies away, because yes, they are selling out like hotcakes, man.
So opening weekend worldwide, more or less than 7 billion.
Well, a little less than 7 billion. I'm no movie prognosticator, but if I was to venture a guess, I'm going to say under 7 bill.
Now here's the trick. I meant yen.
Oh, shoot. Well, now I may be screwed. I'm,
I got you on the record now.
Well, with being American, I certainly don't know any kind of conversions other than U.S.
Now you look like an idiot, Portress.
Well, par for the course, I says.
You wait till I get to the Japanese box office mojo next week.
You haven't been as good since you've been bought out by IMDb box office mojo, just saying. So we'll be talking about Spider-Man No Way Home, and will this be Tom Holland's last Spider-Man film? I don't understand this kid. He's like 19 years old. He's older than that, but it feels like he's 19. He's 19 years old, and he's looking and going, well, I think I'm going to be able to properly get the next Spider-Man into shape and everything. I'm like, what are you talking about? You're not even 30 years old. Just, hey, you can keep being Spider-Man, my dude.
Nathan Drake Uncharted money.
Trust me, he's already shot that film, and that film it comes out next year, and it ain't gonna make no money. I'm just sorry, it's just not.
The same amount of money that whatever the next Rock movie is gonna
exactly.
It'll be a double feature: Skyscraper 2 and Uncharted.
Well, the box office.
Or as I like to call it, Black Adam.
Oh, he's gonna eat his words come this summer. He's gonna eat them so hard.
Look, I want to like that movie. I really do. I want to like that movie, but my God, it looks awful.
Well, can't argue with too much with that. Anywho, that is it for this episode. Everybody, join us next week when we're talking Spider-Man No Way Home. For Sweet Sean Kovacs from the internet, Bruce Leslie, I'm Adam Portra. Stay super, everybody.
Goodbye, Marty and EB.
Mamas, don't let your babies grow up to be cowboys. Don't let them pick guitars or drive them old trucks. Let them be doctors and lawyers and such. Mamas, don't let your babies grow up to be cowboys. 'Cause they never stay home and they're always alone. Someone they love.
Cowboys like smoky old pool rooms and clear mountain mornings.
Little warm puppies and children and girls of the night. Them that don't know him won't like him, and them that do sometimes won't know how to take him.
Just different, but his pride won't let him do things to make you think he's right.
Mama, don't let your babies cry.